Again, we thank you for what you're doing in our lives. And Lord, we thank you for just your grace. And Lord, that we can trust you. And Lord, this morning we lean not on our own understanding coming into 2016. But Lord, we say we trust you with all of our heart. And Lord, we understand and believe and know that you will lead us and that you will guide us. And that, Lord, I pray that you would have your way in our lives. Every person under the sound of my voice this morning, Lord, that I pray that you would speak to by your Spirit, Lord, that you would minister to, Lord, that you would encourage, that you would sharpen, that you would challenge us. Lord, that you would just have your way in our lives this morning and coming into this new year in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you guys have heard me tell my story about my praying grandma who helped to pray me into the kingdom.
Yeah.
And actually, both my grandmas are here this morning, my mom's mom and my dad's mom, and they both prayed for me unceasingly until I had to give up and give in, because ain't nobody can stop a praying grandma.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how many of my friends and people that were in the same situations as me, the same, you know, when, before I met Jesus and he radically transformed my life, I didn't believe in anything. I believed in God. I didn't like church. My parents would drag me out, hated church, and just wanted to do my own thing. And it's amazing how many of my friends are totally lost today, totally. Some of them have committed suicide. Many of them are just in just not very good situations at all. And here I am, and I feel like the richest man in the world, because, you know, I may not have all the money in the world, but I have a beautiful wife who loves me. I have family around me. The blessing of the Lord is evident on my family. It's awesome. Some of you guys might remember Trenton. Who here remembers Trenton from back in the, like, little Trenton? He was one of our foster kids. He's in kids ministry now. But my dad's sister, Marion, and Uncle Ozzie, weren't able to have kids, always wanted kids. And here comes this little Trenton. And you look at my Aunt Marion and Trenton, and they look like identical. Like, this Trenton looks like a little Estonian boy. And because my family, I'm half Estonian, my grandparents are both Estonian, thus their Estonian accents. And they miraculously adopted Trenton as their son.
Yeah.
And just an amazing story, just the blessing of the Lord. And I remember some of those prophecies back in the day that, you know, maybe didn't think were coming to pass, Ozzie and Marion, about you will have a child and God's going to give you a child, and then they didn't get pregnant and a disappointment and stuff. But the word of the Lord is true.
Amen.
And he's trustworthy.
Amen.
And his word always comes to pass.
Amen.
As we stand in faith and belief. So I want to speak for a few minutes this morning. And the word that the Lord gave me was, let us go on to maturity. And Carly and I had a financial meeting the other day with our new financial advisor. And we were talking about mutual funds and all this stuff, and, you know, Carly and I at some point, with not anytime soon, but we want to retire, and we want to retire with money. And so we're looking at investing and everything, and we're halfway, got our little condo paid off and all these things. And he was asking us, what do you want, what kind of investments do you want to, and you want to do, like, you know, aggressive investments, or mildly aggressive, or very safe investments. And I said, well, I want to make 10 to 12% is what I told him. He said, okay, well, that's possible, but you have to be willing for your assets to go like this. And for there to be big dips and small, and, you know, and then big gains and dips. And, you know, some years ago, 2008, who remembers that? The stock markets just went bam. And some people lost half of their assets. If they had $500,000 in mutual funds or whatever their investments were, now they had $250,000. Everyone was going crazy. Well, today the markets are back up, and if nobody sold their mutual funds or whatever, they would be back up and even higher than they were before, because that's just how the markets work. And I'm recognizing this morning, I'm like, man, that's how church works as well sometimes. There's ebbs and flows, and last week we had felt like we had 100 people here. And so I'm like, my family was going to come to church, and I'm like, yes, they're going to see how successful I am and how great of a pastor I am and all these people in my ministry. And then this morning we get here and there's just a handful of us. I'm like, where's my church? You know, and it's tempting to feel discouraged about that. But I recognize, you know, God is the one who's building his church. Amen. And just because people are away for Christmas, I'm so happy to have my family here, regardless. And I'm not going to be fazed by that, because it really doesn't matter what you think of me anyway. I just have to keep being faithful to God. And so this is our last Sunday of the year. And we're going to open to a scripture in a minute. But the word that the Lord gave me, let us go on to maturity. We have a vision at this church. We are going in a direction. We're not just meeting Sunday mornings for the sake of meeting. But the vision of this church, literally, we wrote it out. It's 14 words. Dunamis Church exists so that people may know Christ and walk in the fullness of all they are created to be. So that people may know Christ. Where is Ricky gone? I was just going to use Ricky for a minute, but he's gone. But a year and a half ago, I met this young man called Ricky, and he was high on meth and just dying. And brought him out to church, and slowly but surely, his life got turned around. And today, he has been clean for 7 months. And you got to understand, this is a guy that has been on drugs since the age of 9 or 10. Just totally moved out of his house when he was 14. On drugs. Cheyenne, you probably know some of Ricky's story. But Jesus Christ has transformed his life. Some people, Michelle, you are 42 years old, sorry 41. To expose you. 41, mother of two. And she got saved this year at this church. Actually at Frankie's cell group, and then started coming out. And her life has been totally transformed. Yeah. Completely transformed. She was an alcoholic, suicidal, didn't want to live, and Jesus Christ has changed her whole destiny around. I was just bragging on you, Ricky, a moment ago, just saying what an awesome work God has done in your life. Another woman, Andrea, who's in her early 40s as well, came to this church. She was into New Age stuff and searching. She came to this, she found Jesus, and her life and her daughter's life, Hannah, has been totally changed. And this is what church is about for me. It's not just about gathering. Another example is Sean. Sean, you got saved 4 months ago? 2 months ago?
That's when I surrendered to Jesus.
Yeah. Okay, that's when you surrendered. So you were coming for about a month, and then one day he just said, I got to give it all to Jesus. Yeah. And he was telling me, what happened in your life? You were telling me everything started making sense in life. Confusion left, and just something set in over him where he's alive now as a result of surrendering to Jesus. So this is what this is about, so that people may know Christ and walk in the fullness of all they are created to be. That's why we exist, so that people may know Christ and walk in the fullness of all they are created to be. We had an old vision statement before we created this new one, and people thought it was a little bit aggressive, so we kind of changed it around a little bit. But we used to say, Dunamis Church exists to win souls and make disciples. We want to see people come to the saving knowledge of Jesus. And then we want to, by the grace of God, teach them and transform them into a disciple or a fully fledged follower of Jesus Christ. So, the connection point, now we've been preaching a whole on this for a while, but the connection point of the last season of preaching in life at Dunamis Church has been this, is that your fullness, the fullness of God in your life, is directly connected to you being a disciple of Jesus. There is a big difference of someone who goes to church or someone who confesses to be a Christian and someone who's a disciple of Jesus. There's a huge difference. Jesus didn't save you so that you could warm a seat at church or warm a pew. It's not why he saved you. He saved you so that you could follow him and change the world with him. Amen. That's why you exist. Not just to go to church, but to be a disciple and to transform the world with Jesus. To co-labor, to literally partner with the Holy Spirit to transform lives. So with Ricky, when I was walking home, I dropped my car off to get some work on it. I decided to walk home, and I know it was the Lord. I was going to say the force. It wasn't the force. It was the Lord. But it was the force of the Lord. I just decided to take this back path to get home. You guys are like, oh no, Star Wars. And so I took this back path, and I saw Ricky, and we met, and I was going to spend a nice morning alone, just reading my Bible and just with the Lord. And my morning was hijacked by this kid, Ricky, who was high as a kite and just totally lost. And we ended up going out for breakfast, and then we connected, and I led him to Christ. And then a couple months later, he started coming to church. And that was just the presence of the Lord. Me following Jesus helped to transform a life. And that's what God wants to do with all of us. Yeah. I don't think that I've arrived there, you know, at the epitome of Christian discipline or maturity or something. But God wants to use all of us to co-labor with him to transform lives with the giftings and the callings that he's given us. And it's just awesome. So, in other words, your proximity, your closeness to Jesus will determine the level of life that you walk in. And that I walk in. That's what being a disciple is about. It's not a mysterious concept. It just means, are you seeking God with all of your life and eagerly desiring to follow his voice and do his will with your life? Your proximity to Jesus will determine the level of life that you walk in and the level of life that you're able to give away. Yeah. It's awesome. So Jesus said in John 10:10, we won't have to go there, but he said, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And some of us have had the thief steal some years from our lives. I did. But Jesus said, but I have come that you may have life and life to the full. So that's why Jesus came, to give us life. And that life isn't just like the good life, some money, some, you know, a car, some kids, a job or something like that. But the life of God is effervescent. The life of God, you can tell. I'm not talking about money. I'm not talking about happiness even. You can tell when somebody has the life of God in them. Their eyes shine. There's something different about, there really is something different about a Christian. You're saying like, oh, are you judging? There's, you know, are Christians better? Well, not necessarily better, but they're definitely better off when you have the life of God in you. It's powerful. Jesus said, I have come to give you life. And so when you follow Jesus, you have life. The more you follow him, the more life you have. The more passionately you follow him, the more life of God is going to emanate in you and through you, and the more people that you're going to impact by the life and the Spirit of God coming out of you. And so let's go to Matthew chapter 28. And I'm actually... I've said this before, I actually mean it this morning. I'm going to say it, Mark. I'm going to say it. I'm not. Mark, no, Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Are we going to pull that up, sir? Actually, let's go to verse 16. It says, now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus has directed them. This is after Jesus' resurrection. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So Jesus said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. In other words, Jesus took back the authority from Satan that Adam and Eve had given to Satan, took back all authority, and then passed the ball to us, to the church, to the disciples, and said, go multiply yourselves. You're a disciple, that gives you the power to make disciples. Many people are bored in church nowadays. Christians are just are very confused and bored about their callings because they've never really given everything to Jesus. Because the moment you become a disciple, a fully fledged follower, is the moment that you can begin to make followers of Jesus. That life begins to emanate out of you, and people begin to follow Jesus because you're following Jesus. That's what that means. So this is the ultimate goal of any church, I think. Yeah. It's so simple. A church vision should be surrounded, should come out of this scripture. Because this is the call. This is the commission. This is what we're about as a church, to make disciples. I don't care how you say it, but it's got to be about bringing people to Christ and seeing them follow him with passion so that they can turn around and multiply their lives to see others follow Jesus, so that they can turn around and multiply their lives to see others follow Jesus. I don't know if we understand how close of a tipping point we are at in the world right now to seeing global revival. Did you know that there are 600 million people on planet Earth that speak in tongues? Or claim to have a Pentecostal experience? Did you know that? 600 million. That is more than 1/16 of the world population claim to have a Holy Spirit baptism, speak in tongues, and have an experiential relationship with the Holy Spirit. Confirmation. What if, this is my question, God's been ministering to this to me. What if those 600 million people all brought one person to Jesus in 2016? Yeah. And then did it again in 2017 and did it again in 2018? Yeah. The whole world would be saved. But Christians get bogged down, the enemy gets people bogged down with all this confusion and immature stuff and idolatry and different things. So it's amazing how many believers don't even bring one. Okay. You guys are just looking at me. But this is our call. This is our function as a church, to bring people to Jesus. People that can't, that don't have the capacity to come themselves and bring them to Christ. It's awesome. Okay, let's go to Hebrews chapter 5. If you don't have your Bible, don't worry, it's on the screen. Hebrews chapter 5. Let us go on to maturity. Hebrews 5, verse 12. I think Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, but there's not an author that named their name to it. So whoever the writer of Hebrews is says, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good and evil. Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, and instruction about washings and laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. And this is the word that is resonating in my spirit this morning for us and for our church coming into 2016. Let us go on to maturity. Let us go on to maturity. It's amazing to me. And I speak just from down here. I don't think I'm better than anybody. But it's amazing to me how many believers I see just go around the mountain for years and years and decades, just circling the same issues, the same confusions that the enemy has presented, the same idols, the same struggles, the same sins. And I'm guilty of it too. My wife knows that I've struggled too with this, with things that I ought not to struggle with, things that have held me back in my life. And so do you, if you're honest, don't you? Who here struggles with things? And you know it. And you know if you would lay this down, that God would be able to take you to the next level. If you would lay down some of the things that hinder you. You know, in Hebrews, actually let's go over there for a minute. Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews 12. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So Christians will argue, and I would argue sometimes too, well, it's not sin. Like what I'm doing isn't sin. Yeah, but it's a weight that holds you back from what God has for you. It holds you back from the fullness. You know it's a weight. I know it's a weight. God knows it's a weight. And if you would lay it down, you would be able to run with endurance to the next level that God has for you. But sometimes we don't want to lay down those things because they're just pleasurable or they're fun or they help us to relax or whatever the weight is. I mean, marriages nowadays are being destroyed by video games. Video games. Can you believe that? It's the number two reason for divorce in North America. The man is addicted to video games. Is video games sin? No. But it's a weight that hinders people from walking to the next level. It keeps us back from maturity. So what is maturity? Christian maturity. Is it distinguished by how many sermons you've endured? I remember my dad telling me before, he said, I probably have listened to, over 1,000 sermons in my life. And he wasn't saying that to say, I'm something great. He's just saying he's been in church a long time. And he's seen churches walk around the same mountain, go around the same issues, and not go forward and not go into maturity, into what God has for them. So we're going to go to one more scripture, and I'm going to close. I told you I was going to be quick, but Mark said don't say it. He doesn't believe me. Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. So maturity isn't how long you've been saved. Because there's people that have been saved decades that are still immature in Christ. There's people that have been saved only a few years, yet they're developing a great maturity. So maturity doesn't have to do with how long you've been in the church, although that can help. Maturity has to deal with, we're going to look at it right now. So Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Paul said, I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord. Paul was in prison when he wrote this. He said, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling of which you have been called. Notice he didn't say, I urge you not to walk in sin so that you can receive your calling. No, he said, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy. What does that mean for you? I don't know what it means for you. I know what it means for me, because the Holy Spirit has spoken to me and is speaking to me. But he says, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, with bearing, with one another in love, God only knows how much better a lot of Christians can get at that. Bearing with one another. Bearing with one another's weaknesses. Bearing with one another's personalities. Eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, where there is one body of Christ and one Spirit of God, just as you were called in one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, he gave gifts to men. Verse 10, he who descended is the one who also ascended far above the heavens that he might fill all things. And the gifts that he gave to the church, he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds or pastors, and teachers to equip the saints, verse 12, for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, verse 13, until we all attain to the unity. No. Until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, it says, to mature manhood, or to a full-grown man, to the measure and stature of the fullness of Christ. So, God gives you a church to equip you and to push you. See, one of the problems with, and I was thinking about this morning, and if you don't understand, don't worry about it, you might get it later. But the challenge that pastors face to push believers to walk in maturity in a Laodicean culture is very great. Oh, yes. And it's why I read an article one time about how the greatest reward, remember my dad spoke to me one time, it just stirred me. He said something like, oh, the Christians in China will have such a great reward compared to, you know, many believers in North America who are comfortable. And I remember being a young person at that time going, saying to myself, well, I want a great reward. I mean, I don't know about you, but the kingdom of God is a reward culture, and I sure like rewards. Who here likes rewards? Jesus promised to give rewards to those who labor for him faithfully. The greatest reward in the book of Revelation, where Jesus is talking about all these different churches, he goes through all these different the persecuted church and the church that's poor. And then at the end he talks about the church called the Laodicean church, the church that has everything. They have wealth, they have money, they have enough food, they're not persecuted. But the problem is they're so comfortable, and they're so comfortable in the wealth that they have, in the stuff that they have, that it has pushed them away from the calling of God. They think they have what God has for them, but in actuality, Jesus says, you're blind, you're poor, you're miserable, you're naked, and I counsel you to buy from me gold refined from the fire. So the challenge is, it's such a great challenge for me even as a preacher, to try to get people mature in a culture where you already have everything and you really don't need Jesus. You don't need him for your next meal. You're not relying on him for anything really, because you already have everything. Except the thing that you are relying on him is your spiritual nourishment. But so often we can receive soul food in the form of movies, entertainment, stuff, alcohol, drugs, relationships, music, parties, friends, and we just forget about Jesus. We're so comfortable. So the greatest reward given, which is the reward of sitting on the very throne, you got to read it, Revelation chapter 3 and 4. You'll figure it out. The greatest reward, Jesus says, to those who overcome this Laodicean spirit, this comfortable church, and actually go forward with Jesus into the fullness. Jesus said, I will seat you on my throne beside me forever. I don't know if that interests you at all, to be seated on Jesus' throne with him forever, but it kind of interests me. And I sure would like to be one of those guys And I sure would like to be one of those ministries and one of those churches that overcomes comfort. It's huge. So maturity isn't being in the kingdom a long time or listening to a lot of sermons or preaching a lot of sermons, but maturity is found when you begin to exercise the work that God has for you. Do we have the scriptures back up there, James?
I'm working on restarting it.
I want to show you this. God gives you prophets and pastors and teachers in the body of Christ, and he says this in verse 12, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building the body of Christ. So my question to you is, what work are you doing in the ministry? Because this is the paradigm shift that we're walking into right now, is that pastors and paid ministers are not the ones called to do the work. They're the ones called to equip the saints to do the work. So what's your work? Well, the gift that God gives you will indicate a lot of that, but there's a difference between someone who can sing and play guitar and lead worship, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for Carly Fossey. But your gift is supposed to indicate what work you're called to do. You have a work that God's called you to do. You have a work. You have work. You're actually, every believer is actually called to full-time ministry. You may have never heard that before. Every believer has a calling. Paul said, I pray that you would take your calling seriously. I pray that you would take your calling and that you would walk in a manner worthy of your calling. And your calling is not just to sit in church and, you know, have a nice family and have a good life. Your calling is to follow Jesus as a disciple, emanate his life in you and through you, through the giftings and callings that he's given you, but to make disciples. This is the work that we're called to. Verse 13 says, until we all, that's everybody in the church, attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure and stature of the fullness of Christ. That means you and I, Brandon, walking in the fullness of Jesus Christ. Yeah. It's what God has for every single believer. Yeah. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. I just think it's awesome that you get to be a part of it. Yet, so many believers I see, I know a lot of believers, and a lot of them aren't even in church because they've just gotten bored. They've gotten bored listening to sermons and not being activated, not activating themselves, not understanding the price to be activated. See, the problem is, you actually have to lay down your life. Jesus wasn't kidding when he said, if you want to follow me, you have to take up your cross, deny yourself, and come and follow me. So the problem with that is, it bears repeating again. We live in a culture that screams, please yourself, comfort yourself, it's all for you, get ahead for yourself, make money for yourself. It challenges, that's why one of the things that God immediately says, we can't even get into that. I was thinking about Billy Graham. I have a Billy Graham quote on my computer. And Billy Graham said, give me 5 minutes with a man's checkbook and I'll tell you where his heart is. You know? Because where you invest your money, which represents your life, is so indicative of where your heart actually is, what you value. Anyway, let us go on to maturity. I just pray that this message this morning on Sunday, December 27th, 2015, last Sunday of the year, I pray that you'd be stirred to be a more passionate, a more disciplined, fruitful disciple of Jesus. in 2016. Because fruit, spiritual fruit, it just comes from the presence of God. You can't fake it. You know, there's nothing worse. Well, there probably is worse things, but I'll just say there's nothing worse than listening to a preacher who doesn't have the anointing of the Holy Spirit on his life. So boring. Some of you guys might think, well, is that you? Maybe it is. But I want to get there. I want to get to a greater place, to a greater maturity, to a greater anointing. I want to bring people to a greater place, a greater maturity, a greater anointing, so that people, when people walk in the church, they feel the presence of God. They know God is in the house. God Almighty is in this house. And they're able to bow the knee to Him because He's here. He's here. And that comes when a group of believers follow Jesus with all of their hearts. So that's my prayer for 2016. Let's pray. If God is touching your heart right now, just with all boldness and confidence, if you're just saying, Father, in 2016, I want to be a greater follower of Jesus than I've ever been before in my life. Just stand to your feet right now. I just want to pray with you. I'm already standing because that's me. That's me. And if you stand, God is marking you. I just know, you know. Thank you, Lord. Father, we just humble ourselves before you this morning. And Lord, we want to give you our hearts afresh. We want to give you our hearts. We want to give you our lives. Lord, we want to be followers of Jesus. Just, it's so simple. We don't want to cast away the simplicity that is in following you, Lord. The simplicity that is in following Jesus, just giving you our hearts every day. Seeking to hear your voice. Seeking to follow you. Seeking to be your mouthpiece to people who don't know you. Lord, I pray that for your precious anointing, for your Spirit to fall on every believer under the sound of my voice right now, every person under the sound of my voice. Lord, that you would give us grace to take us to the next level. Lord, that you would give us grace to take us on to maturity. Lord, that you would raise up the teachers among us that are called to be teachers. Raise up the prophets among us, Lord. Raise up the pastors among us, Lord. Raise up our gifts and our callings. Lord, help us to go on to maturity. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Well, that's all I have for you. I think we have Mark if you want to...